If you've ever watched a starry sky at night from a remote location, far away from a city and not affected by light pollution, you may have remained astonished by the huge amount of stars that cover the sky. In fact, you may have been thinking that the universe is probably a place very dense of stars and galaxies. This is somehow true, but only in parts of the universe. In fact, while galaxies are quite rich of stars, the space between galaxies is generally empty. And sometimes these intergalactic spaces can reach enormous sizes, forming huge regions of the universe that are almost completely dark and empty. These regions are known as voids and supervoids. Do you want to hear more about them? Watch this video and I'll tell you more. While you watch a spectacular starry sky at night, you may think the universe is quite uniform, with stars and galaxies scattered all around with no particular differences between one region and another. That's not actually true. In fact, the structure of the universe is quite weird. Let's start our journey from a small scale, and then we will enlarge our vision to see what happens at bigger scales. As you know, stars are grouped into galaxies, which is a concept you are probably familiar with. Galaxies contain an enormous number of stars, hundreds of millions, some of them even hundreds of trillions. In fact, all the stars you see in the sky are part of our galaxy, the Milky Way. While galaxies are very huge objects, the distance separating them is even larger. For instance, while the Milky Way has a diameter of about 100,000 light years, remember, one light year is the distance covered by light in 1 year. The closest galaxy, Andromeda, is 2.5 million light years away. It's about 25 times the size of the Milky Way. But despite these numbers already being very large, galaxies are still quite close to each other in astronomical terms. In fact, galaxies tend to gather into groups due to the effect of the force of gravity bringing them together. These large groups are called clusters. The local group, the cluster where the Milky Way is located, contains about 100 galaxies. And the story goes on. These clusters are gathered into even larger structures known as superclusters containing thousands of galaxies. Here's where things get pretty big. Gravity is always the driving force that shapes the universe, and it keeps playing its role at this level as well. In fact, even these superclusters attract each other. However, at this point, they do not gather into megaclusters or something like that, rather into longer, thin structures known as filaments. In fact, if we could look at the universe at this scale, it would look like a gigantic spider web, but without that rectangular geometric pattern, with these filaments corresponding to the strings of the net. So we now know how the universe looks like at its largest scale, at least as far as we know. These filaments are massive structures spanning over millions of light years. But what's in the space between the strings of this huge spider web? Is there anything between these filaments? That's where things get more intriguing, and that's where we reach the main topic of this video. These spaces between filaments are those called voids and sometimes supervoids. What are they? To understand what voids and supervoids are, we have to talk about density first. Density is a physical quantity describing the amount of matter in a fixed volume. We are all very familiar with this concept. In fact, we are all aware that ice is less dense than water, or that a copper coin is more dense than the air in a balloon, and so on. But what does it mean on a more microscopic way? If we look at a smaller scale, density tells us how close are atoms and molecules to each other in an object or a substance. Higher density means that the atoms and molecules are closer to each other, and so there is less empty space between them. On the other hand, lower density means that atoms and molecules are far from each other. Now we can apply this concept to a larger scale, the universe. But in this model, the atoms are replaced by galaxies. Different regions of the universe have different densities. While most galaxies are concentrated in the filaments, voids are almost completely empty. In fact, the density of these voids is less than 1/10 of the average density of the rest of the universe. Therefore, these voids are big regions of space relatively empty, containing very few galaxies compared to clusters and superclusters. Some of these voids can even merge together, forming huge ones, which are sometimes referred to as supervoids. The biggest known supervoid, the Boötes Void, has a diameter of about 300 million light years. It's more than 3,000 times the size of our galaxy. It's no coincidence that it is sometimes called the Great Nothing. But how did these objects form, and why are they so important for the universe? Before we discover more about voids and supervoids, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve and make these videos better for you, the viewer. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel, clicking the bell so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. To understand the origin of voids and supervoids, we have to do a little step back in time when the universe was still at its early age. Just after the Big Bang, the universe was consisting of a plasma, which is often referred to as the fourth state of matter, the other three being solid, liquid, and gas. You should be familiar with them. In a plasma, the three fundamental particles, protons, neutrons, and electrons, are not arranged into atoms or molecules like in the other three states, but they are just free to move alone. We can think of it as a chaotic state, in which all particles are moving randomly without any bond with each other. At the beginning, the universe was very hot. This means that all these particles were moving super fast. In fact, the speed of the particles is related to the temperature. The higher the temperature, the faster the particles move. Too fast, actually, so they were not able to form atoms yet. In order to form an atom, protons must be able to capture the electrons, but if the electrons are moving too fast, this won't happen. As the universe kept expanding, it also cooled down, and the temperature got lower. At the same time, particles started moving slower and slower, and at some point, protons became able to catch electrons to form the simplest atom in the universe, hydrogen. This very important moment is sometimes called recombination. Later, as the temperature of the universe continued decreasing, protons and electrons, and neutrons as well, became able to form atoms of heavier elements as well, helium, carbon, oxygen, and so on. However, this process didn't happen uniformly in the whole universe. In fact, as atoms started to form, some regions resulted in having more density than others. And it's here that gravity started to play a fundamental role in the density of the universe. In fact, as the first atoms appeared, they started to attract each other due to the force of gravity. And as atoms aggregated, they kept attracting more and more. As these groups of atoms grew larger in size, the force of gravity they exerted on the surrounding areas became stronger, attracting more atoms and becoming larger and larger. So regions with higher density grow faster in size. On the contrary, regions with lower density could exert less attraction due to weaker force of gravity. So they were able to gather less atoms. As this process went on, the universe became less uniform. Regions with higher density attracted more and more matter, while regions with less density became emptier. The former are those that we now call clusters and superclusters, while the latter are those that we now call voids and supervoids. So this is how they formed. Okay, we now have understood the origin of these enormous regions with very few galaxies inside, and also that because of their low density, they exert very little gravitational attraction. So how do they play a role in the universe? In reality, these voids and supervoids exert some force, but a totally different kind. It is in fact a repulsive force. What is it? Before answering this new question, we need to do another little step back and talk about the composition of the universe. In fact, the universe consists of three main components: ordinary matter, and dark energy. What are they? Let's start with ordinary matter, which is the easiest one. Ordinary matter includes all the objects that we are familiar with: planets, stars, galaxies, even black holes. Basically, all the things in the universe that we are somehow able to detect with our instruments, even those that are too far away to be seen. While our common sense would suggest that these objects constitute the majority of the universe, it may be surprising to hear that ordinary matter actually only makes up 5% of the universe. Yes, ordinary matter is just a small fraction of the whole universe. Then what about the rest? Let's now move to dark matter. Dark matter includes all matter that we are not able to detect. Okay, wait, but if we are not able to see it, how can we be sure it's there? The thing is, even if we cannot directly observe it, we are able to see the effects it has on ordinary matter. In fact, dark matter exerts gravitational attraction as well, so it produces visible effects on other familiar objects, such as stars and galaxies. There are indeed many proofs of the existence of dark matter. For example, it turns out that the velocity of rotation of stars in the outermost region of galaxies is too fast, and it can be explained only if there is additional matter inside the galaxies that we cannot detect. Another example is the so-called gravitational lensing. The gravitational force exerted by matter is able to curve light from distant objects. In certain regions of space, the amount of ordinary matter is not enough to get the lensing effect that we observe for some distant objects. It can only be explained by assuming that there is additional matter in between, which is indeed the dark matter. Okay, but wait, what does this dark matter contain? The answer is we don't know. It must be particles that do not emit light nor radiation, because they are invisible to us, but we have only hypotheses so far. And what is more surprising is dark matter constitutes about 27% of all the things in the universe, which is an important fraction. Okay, so we are now left with the third and last constituent of the universe, dark energy. What is it? Well, I know it may sound very disappointing, but the answer is, we have no idea. Yes, that's right, this thing represents almost 70% of the whole universe, and we don't even know what it is. The only thing we know is that it is some form of unknown energy that permeates the whole space, and it pushes somehow galaxies apart. So it acts as a repulsive force, the opposite of gravity. This effect plays a very important role. In fact, the reason for which the expansion of the universe is currently accelerating is indeed the presence of dark energy. And getting back to our main topic, dark energy is strictly related to voids and supervoids. In fact, we can think voids and supervoids as huge reservoirs of dark energy, like giant bubbles that keep expanding, getting larger and larger in size, pushing galaxies apart, far away from each other. In a certain way, we can say that these fascinating objects are somehow responsible for shaping the universe. If you think about it, it almost sounds like a paradox. Regions that are almost empty are responsible for determining the fate of the universe. How weird is that? But in the end, we shouldn't be too surprised about that. We already knew that the universe was a bizarre place. That's it for this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. Did you find voids and supervoids an interesting topic? Is there anything more you want to discuss about them? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.